Hello, coffee drinkers. We are doing pedal awesomeness today. Gonna be looking at two different pedals that I was given. Literally, one was just handed to me at the baked potato the other night, and the other one I got from this guy called Juan down in Buenos Aires, Argentina. It's called the Balls On. It's a compressor and drive, like overdrive. So compressor, combined compressor overdrive pedal, and it's by BSQ Effects down in Buenos Aires, Argentina. The other one we're gonna be taking a look at today is something that was literally just handed to me at the baked potato the other night, right before the gig. It is a compression limiter made by Miura Guitars. I have no idea how either of these pedals work, so I'm gonna put the pedal board together and get stuck in. Today, basically, with two compression pedals, one of which also has an overdrive, the Balls On by BSQ Effects, and then this compressor that was compressor limiter that was given to me the other day at the 55 bar. So this is our clean signal. I have some toys in the chain which I'll use later. OC2, fuzz. And of course, a little delay for stuff, and I have the looper at the end of the chain. So that's super simple setup. Let's go with the Balls On. That's the overdrive in the pedal. Now with the compressor. I guess there's a blend between the two, so you can go more overdrive and less compression, or more compression, less overdrive, and then blend through. I kind of like the sound more kind of right in the middle, maybe with a P bass with a pick, that would sound actually pretty happening. And then basic controls, there's like a pad, I guess like minus 10 dB, something like that. An attack button, you can give it a little more attack, you can change the tone and the style. I'm not a massive fan of changing the tone, I kind of like to dictate that a lot with the fingers, but on some of these pedals, especially with overdrive and distortion, changing the tone can have a huge impact on the rest of the pedals in the chain. If I just go with the compressor on this one and put the OC2 in there as well. Now the OC2 without the compressor and with gives it a bit more balls, I think. Maybe with the overdrive as well. Now you don't hear so much of the overdrive now with it because it's pre. I kind of like to have the distortions and the overdrives after the octave, so it's not actually doing too much to that. But I kind of like some of the characteristics of it. Could be one of those kind of X-factor pedals in the setup. Does give it a nice amount of sustain. I gotta say that. That's pretty awesome. Still going. Check that out. Wow. I do like that a lot.
Yeah, there are some really nice characteristics with that. I could have a lot of fun kind of looping and creating weird sounds with that. So that's the Balls On BSQ Effects compressor and overdrive. Let's go with the Miura guitars. This is the M2 compressor limiter. Again, here's the clean sound. Now we go with the compressor. I gotta say, when I was messing around with it and first dialing it in, I didn't really feel the compression as much. Now, I gotta say, it's really subtle and soft and warm. I do like that about it. And it's a lot to do, for me, it's a lot to do with the feeling that it gives me when I play, like the reaction and kind of the different control I have with my fingers, especially in the right hand. Go without it. Yeah. Big difference there. Yeah, if I sustain a chord and then definitely giving it a big bump there. See, with a little delay perhaps. Yeah, let's go with a little delay and not a ton of delay. Very warm. Let's do that without. Massive difference between the two, actually. I was wondering how they would compare and if I would like one more than the other or whether they would just be totally different. I think they're just totally different. And the Balls On, the BSQ Effects one was kind of a little more crunchy and had a little more defined tone things. This one is a lot warmer, but I kind of like characteristics of both of them. I wouldn't say, oh, this one is better or that one is better. They're just actually quite different. So I appreciate the fact, A, that two people were kind enough to give me these pedals to check out, because pedals are always fun, right? And also that I don't just have two compressors now. I have two compressors, one of course with the overdrive, but I have two pedals that do quite different things, even though they're kind of designed, I guess, in a similar way. That's all without. Let's go with. Really beautiful and warm, that one. I kind of am gravitating more towards chord stuff and kind of melodic stuff with the Miura guitars pedal. And let's go back to the Balls On. Woo! A little more aggressive. That's probably got a lot to do with the way I have it set up. It's just, again, a totally different characteristic, totally different sound. And plus I can add the overdrive. Ooh, good for pinch harmonics. Kind of like they're both bringing a smile to my face for completely different reasons, which is really nice. That feels really nice to play chords. Thank you. is pretty cool. Let's see how the OC2 reacts with the Miura compressor. Balls on. With a little more mid-range in there, maybe I can change the tone a little bit. But that's fun, that's a lot of fun. Okay, that concludes my tech review of pedals. I love pedals. I love messing with them. I don't know too much about them despite owning hundreds of them. But hopefully that gave you a look inside two pedals that are brand new to me. Hopefully they're brand new to you. I will post links below in the description of this video if you want to go check out these companies. I'm not, you know, being paid to do any of this. They gave me a free pedal. That is the extent of our relationship. I like them both for very different reasons. And as you guys know, like, I wouldn't normally put the pedals in the video if I didn't really like them. I'm always trying to bring out something positive when I do like a review or a kind of a showcase of something new like this. And it's super fun for me to get to know the pedal, discover a few new things about it, and get to share that with you at the same time. Okay, pedal review is over. Let's get on and answer some questions from the vlog from a couple of days ago where I gave you some concert footage of the Bob Reynolds gig at the 55 Bar. There were so many comments and questions. That is awesome. I can't say this enough, guys, that I really appreciate it when you guys step in and you communicate and you ask questions and we have the opportunity to do this. So I get to answer all your questions right now. I'm going to go to that vlog. If you haven't seen that vlog, it's vlog number 129, April 7th, 2017. And the title is About Last Night. The most recent comment left 3 hours ago by Liam Owen. And Liam says, hey, Janek, I love the way you move when you play. I'm really interested in how our physicality affects the way we play. And it's something I talk about with young players a lot. I'd love to hear how you think the way you play is influenced by your physicality, how your love of sport informs your music, and vice versa. Loving the vlog. I find it inspiring as a fellow bassist and a nosy bugger. Well, cool. Liam, thanks very much for chiming in and giving some feedback here. Our physicality, I think, is a huge element of our playing, and it affects it in a big way. You know, if I'm kind of feeling, you know, bloated and lethargic and, you know, not kind of turned on mentally, I'm really not going to give the best performance possible. So the more in shape I can be, both in body and in mind, I think the better the performance is going to be, because I'm going to be able to be more present, to have more energy, to be more focused, to be able to listen to people around me more. You know, there's nothing like feeling like that. You know, that blair feeling. I never want to feel like that. And if I haven't exercised in a while, if I've not been eating the right things, if I've been drinking the wrong things, then that's kind of how I feel. So I try and go as much as possible towards being in as best shape as I possibly can whenever I go to play, which is kind of something I want to be consistent with. That's not something I do it in waves. That's something I'm really trying to be dedicated to every day, so that whenever I step on stage to play music, I feel as good as I possibly can. Next comment, South Gallatin says, drummer is killer. Yes, could not agree with you more. Drummer is killer. Sean is a bad dude. Next comment comes from Usema Ahal. I'm not sure how to pronounce that name. Honestly, I feel like the drummer overplayed a little in the beginning, like in a triplet groove fill. He puts way too much 16th note type of fills and too much tom fills. I don't know, my opinion, it didn't sound musical. You know what? I know exactly what you're talking about, and the first clip I put in the video, you know, the directive from Bob, I don't think Sean overplayed at all. I think there are spots in those clips and on that gig where we all overplayed. Bob, me, Sean, Roslyn, we probably played a few too many notes that we could have done without. We could have like left them in the bag. So we're probably all guilty of that. You know, the directive specifically for that piece of music, and I know what you're talking about, the directive is really for big drums. That's what Bob wants specifically in that. It's meant to be a huge drum thing with kind of a lot of filling and 16th notes going against the triplets, you know, over that kind of 3-4 feel. So, you know, it's completely subjective. You might hear it unmusically, I might hear it musically, and the next person might hear it in a completely different way. So there's no right or wrong way to hear it. I don't think there's a right or wrong way to play it. I personally think Sean played great, and I think that was one of the best versions of that song we've ever done as a band. That night in general was one of the best shows we've played as a band, so there are a lot of positive things to come out of it. And yes, there are a couple of things I've listened back to and thought, God, I wish I didn't play that lick, or I wish I'd have played a little simpler with the bass line. You know, there are things I've listened back to and thought, well, you know, maybe we could have done less piano there, or less drums, or less saxophone, or more even of certain things. There's always personal opinion that gets in there, but I think the main thing to keep in focus is the overall performance and how great the overall performance as a band and as a unit was. So yes, few things stuck out to my ear in places. I'm sure if you asked Sean, he would say the same thing about me and Ruslan and Bob, and probably about himself as well. Super honest guy when it comes to his playing, very open-minded and likes to listen. So I think that's true for everyone in the band. They're very open-minded, they like to listen, and they're open to criticism, and they can give constructive criticism and give and take, and just make it better, continually get better, which is exactly what that band has done. It has gone from strength to strength in terms of our performances. So I think overall, amazing performance. Yes, everyone's entitled to their opinion as to what they hear as musical or not. I personally don't think there was too much overplaying on that gig at all. Anyway, great question from Reese Weber. Hi, Janek. Question, how much effort do you put into not overplaying? As a drummer, I find that it is the habit I most struggle to break. The music generally seems to benefit when everyone plays just enough, but not too much. Yeah, I don't put effort into not overplaying. Not overplaying comes from experience, I think, and from understanding my place in the band and where I fit and where I can add things and where me playing too much will detract from the music. So I'm really conscious of serving the song. I'm conscious of what's going on around me, what the other musicians are doing, and through those two things, it's a very natural thing not to overplay. And you know, I know exactly when I overplay as well, because it sticks out so much and I'm listening so hard, and even though it's me that's played it, I kind of like, it gives me a little bit of a shock, and I jump back and go like, oh man, that was stupid. You know, really shouldn't have played all that junk. And it kind of, you know, sets me up for the next time. Perhaps it was at a certain point in the song, perhaps it was a very common place to play a fill, and I'll just lay out the next time around. So it's a definite kind of, you got to keep checking in with yourself and figure out where you're at in the band, where you're at in the mix. You know, I like to mix everyone else really close and myself like way far away. You know, I know what I do, I know what my abilities are, I know where my sound is, I'm very comfortable with that. I'm of course less familiar with those people around me, even people I've been playing with for a long time. Just the nature of the number of hours I've spent playing alone and the number of hours I've spent playing with other people, there's a big disparity in the amount of time there. So I like to mix everyone else in my personal little cue mix in my brain. I like to mix everyone else really, really close so I can pay attention to them and me kind of way in the back. And when I do play too much, like I'll jump forwards myself in the mix and go, hey, what are you doing here? Like, get out of here. You know, and that will kind of keep me in check as far as overplaying goes. Next question is from Pete Sabramovich. Hey Janek, dig the vlog, thanks, great performance too. Awesome Pete, thanks for checking in. What are some things you look for in people who you collaborate with, improv or not, for the purpose of landing gigs? Wow, I mean, there are so many human things, like, you know, like if I've got to spend a lot of time with someone in a tour bus on the road for weeks on end, you know, personal hygiene is probably a massive part of, you know, whether I want to collaborate with someone or be on tour with them. You know, basic human kind of necessities, like that kind of stuff. When it comes to the music, being open-minded is a massive part of it. Really being a team player, bringing something unique to the music. I mean, there are so many elements. You know, not everyone, including myself, has all of those elements working at exactly the same time. So there are different things that I look for, and tough to put it, you know, it's kind of tough to make a definitive, like, these are the five things you must have. I mean, there are probably five really important things that you must have in terms of like time and sound and professionalism and like being on time and showering more than once a month and those kind of things. But it really, really depends on the music and on the person and on the situation and all of that kind of stuff. Next question is from Wojciech Justyna, and he asks, hey Janek, great set. What did you record the audio with? Just the camera mic, or do you have a special setup to record audio at gigs? On that gig, I just used the GoPro, the session, this little guy right here, the GoPro session 5, Hero, I don't know what it is. It's the GoPro session. I'm going to do a video on this because it is such a badass camera. I'm going to do a complete video about the GoPro session because I think it is awesome and I think all musicians should have one. But that is what I recorded the gig on, and it came out pretty well for just a little camera and in low light and, you know, no audio source or anything like that. So yeah, GoPro session 5. Next question is from Frank Bethel. Hey Janek, quick question. Do you find that energy feeds your playing more when you are standing versus sitting? I never perform sitting and definitely notice a difference. It is like sitting requires me to be more closed off and standing requires me to be more open, not just physically, but emotionally. Any thoughts? Also, love the fluorescent shoelaces. Well, thank you, Frank. It's a big difference, yeah, between sitting and standing. You know, when I'm doing the solo, the last minute world tour, when I'm doing the looping, I have to sit down. I have to be close to the pedals. I like to manipulate the knobs and the parts and just be, you know, close by with my feet. Standing up, I can really rock out a little more. So they are two very different situations to perform in, but you know, I can get it done both ways, you know, and kind of different situations require a different thing, you know, and I try and make a balance of that, like half sitting, half standing on a gig, you know, depending on what it is, whether it's a really high energy gig or whether it's a solo performance. I just kind of feel it out and go with the flow. Next question is from Mr. Buak Buak. I see both of your cabs are on the floor. Can you tell us about position placing cabs? Why not stacked? Well, I like it. It wasn't the ideal setup at the Baked Potato. I like to be in the center of the cabs and have them spread out one either side, sort of facing a little bit inwards and then way behind me. That just gives me a nice feeling. I can feel it vibrate a little bit through the stage. And it also helps me with my monitoring on stage as well, especially if I don't have in-ears or I don't have a dedicated monitor. So that's why I do it not stacked. Of course, it's not always possible. Like when I'm playing at the 55 bar in New York, for instance, I'm stuck right in the corner. I have to stack them up because there just isn't the space. And I deal with it. But ideally, I like to have them a little bit spread out, a little bit angled in, and that helps me with my on-stage monitoring. Okay, we're going with one more question because it's a good one and it's a long one, and there were a few replies to it and some discussion on the thread. So let's end today's vlog with this one. It's from Mike Ryan. He asks, how come when the bass takes a solo, in parentheses, and I've noticed this in common to almost all performances, not just this one, everyone else drops out? Bob drops out for the keyboard and drum solos, but everyone else goes on lunch break when you take one. Okay, really specific to that song and to what I like to do in terms of like starting something really kind of new within the song. I specifically ask everyone to stay way the hell out of my way for the first few minutes of me doing that. So yes, a lot of drummers and a lot of keyboard players, a lot of band members in general do drop out when there's a bass solo. That normally drives me nuts, especially when it's just me playing the bass and there's no looping going on. But when I'm looping and I'm really looking for something new, I'm not trying to stay even in the same tempo of the song, maybe not even the same key. I'm trying to like get a completely fresh slate. That is definitely my preference, is for everyone to drop out. And then I get to create something new and then they get to listen to that and pick it up and come in exactly as they did on the gig. I thought it worked really well. I thought the musicality of the way they crept in with Sean and Ruslan creeping in there, and then I was able to fade the loop out, and there wasn't really much of a drop in terms of the vibe. That was perfect to me. That worked really, really well. And those guys are so musical that they know how to do that. I thought Sean did an excellent job of coming in and staying in time with the loop, and just, he didn't overplay. He played quieter. He was really listening, and everyone was listening. That was the key thing. So that really wasn't a problem on that performance. I felt maybe that was the most connected we'd been in months in terms of our performance together. So just a ton of major wins on that gig in terms of the communication and the performance. As to the whole thing of the bass being louder when everyone drops out, I don't really know. I have a volume knob that I can crank the living hell out of if I want to. I really don't need to. You know, other members of the band should really know how to play with intensity at a lower volume and have a dynamic range that allows a solo to shine out of the ensemble situation if that's what the situation calls for. So just be aware of the fact that everyone should shoulder the responsibility of dynamic range, and everyone should have the ability to play with intensity no matter what the volume. That's a huge key for the success of, you know, especially if you're playing with an acoustic bass player who might not have as much volume or as much projection. You know, listen to Brian Blade comp on drums for an acoustic bass solo, for a Christian McBride solo with Joshua Redman's quartet, for instance. It's outstanding how intense he can be. Or Jorge Rossi behind Larry Grenadier, or Jeff Ballard behind Larry Grenadier in Brad Meldow's trio. It's incredible how intense those guys can be at a low volume and provide support and motion and interaction and conversation and communication. That's huge. I think everyone should check that out. The drummer does not lead the band. The ride cymbal does not lead the band. The walking bass does not lead the band. The band leads the band as a collective unit. Are there people who give signals sometimes? Absolutely. Are there people who make decisions on what repertoire to play? Yes. But in the moment, in the groove, the band should be working as, I think anyway, as a single unit, all listening to each other and evolving and moving and changing direction together at the drop of a hat, because they have the skills and the dynamic range to play with intensity at any volume and in the context of any situation. Holy cow. Okay, that's it. I'm done. This vlog ended up being super long and I wanted it to be super short, but I don't mind. I love doing it. If you guys are cool with the length of these vlogs, leave me some feedback about that. You know, so I posted a couple of vlogs that were like 10 minutes and under and people were like, man, what do I do with the other half of my coffee? And then, you know, I haven't had any negative feedback on long vlogs yet, so leave me some comments. That'd be really interesting to know what's going on there, how people dig the longer ones, the shorter ones, the mid-range ones, what's perfect for you guys. Leave me some comments. Of course, ask me some more questions if you like. That's what the comments section is about. But today's vlog is done, and I will see you guys tomorrow.